Thank you. Thank you very much, and good morning. And it's always a pleasure and an honor to host you here at the Edmund J. Safra Synagogue and to exchange ideas and to participate and play a role in really bringing peace to the world and understanding between nations and religions. You will excuse me, I will have to run by 9:45 or so. I have to catch a flight. My duties somewhere else are calling upon me, but I will be here until that time. So basically, it is the world is made up of so many different people, different thoughts, different religions, different ethnicities. And the challenges that humanity faces on a day-to-day basis is the ability to serve, not just to survive, to live together and to prosper together and to progress together. Unfortunately, the history of humanity has not been like that most of the time that that the world has been in existence. But it is still a challenge for us and a mission for all of us as children of God to be able to find a way to live together in peace and tranquility and to help each other be able to progress. That is the mission that God has given to us when He created the world. And that is, as we are all His children, we are all His children. And therefore, it is incumbent upon us. It is like in a family. When a family of many children, the parent sees that the kids are fighting, it brings a great distress to the parents. And we know them as parents ourselves, when we see our own children fighting, that it brings a great distress to the parents. And of course, the parents not going to take sides, but they try to manage those fights. And how happy are the parents who sees that their children are getting along, they're helping each other, they're respecting each other. Each child God has created, as our sages say, that keshem shepar sufehem shonim kach de'otehem shonot, the same way that each one of us looks different, we all have different face, that's how our thoughts are. We have different opinions. Even in one very close-knit family, each child has different opinion. That's how God created us, to give us the ability to choose freely, to decide freely, to be our own entity. And therefore, we ought to respect each other's thoughts, each other's opinions, in brotherly love and cooperation with each other. So there, here, when it comes to, from the part of the Jewish religion, the most ancient religion amongst the Abrahamic religions, of course, it's a religion that stresses significant importance on peace, on the word peace, shalom. Shalom is a very famous word all over the world. Almost any member of the world knows what shalom means. Shalom has several significance. Shalom means peace, of course, that's the meaning. Shalom also is used when you meet somebody and is also used when you say goodbye to somebody. Shalom, when you meet somebody, you can tell them shalom, and then when you spoke to them, have done everything, and then on the way out, you could still say shalom to them. So shalom is always the greeting in the Jewish religion and the Jewish community. When it comes to the Sabbath, we say Shabbat shalom, meaning the peaceful Sabbath. So the word shalom really accompanies us all the time. Not only that, our sages tell us that God Himself took upon Himself to name, one of His names is shalom. Shalom is also the name of God, because our God is the God who wants to make peace in the world. It's our God who stresses the importance of peace amongst his children. So even His name is considered to be Shalom. Another thing also that our sages tell us in the Talmud is that the best utensil of blessing that God gave His people is Shalom, is peace. Because as it says, Hashem yevarech et amo b'shalom. God blesses His people and His nation with peace and tranquility. And so, as a religion, we understand that that the Torah, which is the basic book of the books, right? The Bible is the book of the books. It inspired many religions to spring forth from the Bible, but it inspires also many nations to constitute as such. Of course, one of the most famous one is basically the United States, based on Judeo-Christian values and the Bible. And of course, all of Western civilization has been based on that. So the Bible itself, the Torah, the constitution of the Jewish people, so to speak, we understand that that was not meant for all of humanity. The principles of it, yes, the ritual part of it, it's not. It's only for the Jewish people. However, the principles of it is really a universal principle of believing in one God, murdering, not stealing, and not lying, and creating justice in the world. All of those, what we call them as the seven Noahide laws, the seven laws of the children of Noah, which means of the rest of humanity, which is, as I said, the belief in one God, creating justice, no committing adultery, no committing murder, no stealing, not lying. And so all of those are principles of humanity that all of us can live with. And certainly the principle of shalom, of peace, it is the glue that really gets us all together and united. It is also understood, therefore, the Jewish religion never practiced proselytization, never practiced trying to convince others to become Jewish, because we understood that the Torah was not meant for everybody or anybody. A person would like to, of course, they're more than welcome. But they don't have to become upstanding citizens or good humans that they have to follow the Torah, as long as they follow those seven Noahide laws, which are the principles of humanity. And so therefore, Judaism never forced any nation or any people or even any individual to become Jewish and to follow Judaism under no penalty at all, because it was not necessary, it's not demanded of us to convert anybody to become Jewish. And that is the source of, I think, internecine fights between nations and people. It is the idea of imposing one's religions upon others. And unfortunately, history has shown us that other religions did that in the past, and some of them still doing it today. And that has become the source of animosity, of fights, of war, of unfortunately genocide, by imposing the religion of one upon the rest of humanity. Judaism never practiced that. Judaism is for the Jewish people, the general principles of humanity of the rest of the humanity. And therefore, we never imposed on anybody the need to become Jewish, to become redeemed or saved, or upstanding human citizens. And I think that is where we ought to concentrate on making sure that religious leaders of any other religion understand and respect other nations when they have other religions and other faiths, because that is what their belief is, that is what their faith is. We could more than happy expose the faith of everybody to anyone, as long as we don't impose that on anybody, either by force or by any other means. I think that is, as I said, the source of many conflicts in the world throughout history. But if we respect each other's religions, each other's beliefs, and each other's faiths, then that is a secure recipe for peace and tranquility and understanding amongst all the nations and religions. So I will stop here. We'll give my dear friend Sheikh Agha Jafri to speak, and then we'll take brief questions and answers. Thank you very much and welcome.
Good morning, shalom, and assalamu alaikum. Rahmatullahi barakatuh. Dear friends, I am so gratified that my old and dear friend Rabbi Abadie and now Dan, Mark Danfried, have invited us to speak representing the views of Islam as to what we can do as human, as the Rabbi has pointed out, to really enhance and enlarge the agenda of peace in the universe that we live in. Brothers and sisters, if you don't mind, I will refer you, unless you like, said, ladies and gentlemen, which is the same thing. My purpose here is to really explain to you, because the problems as we see it, it's really got a deep roots into the history and all that. Islam was created in the year 600, as you all know. Mother religion, we consider Judaism was a mother religion. That was 3,000 years, Rabbi? 3,400 years, and then Christianity, of course, 2,000. Islam came into being, as you know, in the year 2000. I mean, 1,400 years ago, year 600. The advent of Islam started at Mecca and Medina, where the prophet of Islam, his revelations declared that there's only one God. Allah is one God, same God, our God, and Muhammad is his prophet. The people there, they were Jews and they were Christians. They lived in peace in Mecca. Would you believe that they were the people of the book, people of the Abraham. We all are, the three religions I'm talking about, the people of Abraham and the children of Abraham and the people. And there was no problem at all, absolutely none whatsoever. It sort of progressed through the time. He had to migrate to Medina for reasons which are beyond discussion here. And then, of course, his death ensued. During his life, short life, he appointed a successor in which he said that his son-in-law's cousin would be his successor, and then it went on into something, even though it's controversial. But I just want to discuss that immediately after the death of the Prophet. I'm trying to be as fast as possible, fast forward this thing, so that you understand briefly as to why some of these things are the way they are. Why there are Shi'as and why there are Sunnis, why there are sects in Islam. Immediately after his death, or at the time of his death, the question of succession came into debate, and it was said the people who were there at the time the Prophet nominated Ali, his son-in-law, as his successor, people objected to that, said no, Ali cannot be, and they had somebody else, Ghani Abu Bakr, and they said Abu Bakr should be the thing, and that controversy did not arise, because the people, the party of Ali, who later called themselves Shia, they backed off. They were busy in the funeral and the burial of the Prophet. So after that, the caliphates started. We call them Khulafa Rashidun, four of them. And after those Khulafa, then came the dynasties of Banu Umayyah and Bani Abbas, and then everything was progress that was going all right. The religion was peaceful. There were not many massacres, not many atrocities. Of course, you know, there are the debacles and there are conflicts and all that. Internal, the family feuds did take place, but that did not have any real ramification until year 1200. A man by the name of Abu Taymiyyah, Ibn Taymiyyah, came into picture. That man, you should remember his name. You should never forget his name. He is the father of Salafi Islam. Salafi in Arab, Salafi means Islam, Rabbi, and these are the forebears. He said that these Muslims, the one they are right now, they are, this is saying this in 1200 years, they are nothing. They are wrong, they have polluted the religion, they have gotten into rituals, and they are not practicing true Islam. However, our forebears, what they did, that's the Islam we wanted, and he instituted which became known as Salafism, or the current day Wahhabi. Ladies and gentlemen, that is the root cause of the entire debacle in the dispute. That is what the Godot. That's where the rubber meets the road. These Salafis were, somehow or other, he was able to attract the attention of all the masses. They believed in him, and of course a movement started to discredit the Khulafa and the Prophet and everybody, the family of the Prophet and everything. And then in year 1700, his another disciple of his, Muhammad ibn Abdul Wahhab came, which is called the real mentor of Saudi Arabia, the present day Saudi Arabia. So Muhammad ibn Abdul Wahhab followed this thing, and his movement, Wahhabism and Salafism, became the cause. All this fitna, all this problem, all this difficulty, tragedy, is because of this Salafism and this Wahhabism. That's the root cause. Muslims, these people said that Shia Muslims, Hanafi Muslims, Hanbali Muslims, Maliki Muslims, they are not Muslims. Unless you are Wahhabi, if you believe in the Wahhabi faith, and this Salafi doctrine, you are not Muslims. And that doctrine is totally not too much far from the Nazi doctrine, exclusion. Nobody is a Muslim, except the Salafis and the Wahhabis are. And of course, I mean, you know, much less the Christian and Jews. Infidels, they should be massacred. They should not be, they should be either converted or they should be massacred. There's no other option. And this thing is the reason that we are facing. First and foremost, as a Muslim, I'm saying this thing, Islam must have to fix this problem before any interfaith. We have to deal with this monstrosity, which is called intrafaith. We have problems amongst Muslims, the Shia and the Sunni. And the I just want to let you know that even though Shia and Sunni are very popularly known as the two sects, but you have to understand one thing, there are five schools of thought in Islam. That's what really is the whole thing, you must understand. They're called Hanafi, following of the Imam Hanifa, Maliki, Hanbali, Shafi'i, and Jafri. Jafaris are Shias, and the rest of the four are the Sunni. So even though there are two sects, but these are five schools, and they differ, Rabbi, tremendously, and Rabbi knows about that. So that's where the problem is, and this cult, I call it a cult of the Wahhabi and Salafi, and tremendous amount of there's a trove of data, and the information which is being given to the Western public about the about what you call Salafism, and they know that is and the our governments are fighting, and the Western powers are involved into this thing, and so on and so forth. Now, the next thing which I want to talk about is very briefly again is that the migration of the Muslims on the Western shores. This only is a 50 or 60 year old phenomenon. In the United States, as you know, President Lyndon Johnson signed a legislation in 1965, which allowed for the first time. You know, prior to 1965, only 100 people, and even from the Northern Europe, were allowed to come to the Northern Europe, whether they were Muslim or Jews, they were allowed to come to the United States. But as a result of that legislation in 1965, the floodgates were open, and there came a migration en masse, where I would say millions of people from Africa, continent of Africa, the Middle East, Asia, and all over started coming to the Eastern Europe, started coming to the United States. And now we had, now the population of, I'm only going to talk about Muslims, the population of Muslims, Rabbi, even though certain Islamic organizations will tell you, Isna, Ikna, Kier, they tell you there are 8 million Muslims, 9 million Muslims. According to Pew, and I depend on Pew more than I depend on this thing, there are only 4 to 4.5 million Muslims in the North America, not more than that. Make no mistake about that. I mean, the people exaggerate, they have a right to exaggerate, just like I'm trying to underestimate the number, but Pew has now these people, of course, could come somewhere, at the back. There are pockets in our population, in the Muslim population, of the Wahhabi and Salafi elements. Well, you call them sleeping cells. And they're very dangerous. They are more harmful to us Muslims than they are to you, Jews and Christians. First, they want to knock us out because they think we are the cause of the problem. We are the one who are emboldening, we are enhancing, we are strengthening the cause of Christians and Jews. And their mission is to just simply destroy the Western civilization. They believe in Prophet, and the quite opposite to the Judaism, they believe that the only way for survival and sustenance is to proselytize. Let's make everybody Muslim, either by sword or by bullet, every which way. But we want everybody to be a Muslim, whether they are in the United States or Europe or North America, the whole world should be a Muslim. And not just Muslim, their brand of Islam, which is Wahhabism and Salafism. It saddens me to, I'm not saying something very, very dramatic, anyway, it's a universally known fact, and that is the problem. So we have to get to the root cause. I'm a blogger, I blog, and I've been writing for the last 25 years about these issues, and there is nothing you can do, this problem cannot be solved unless we get rid of this menace, which is called the Wahhabism and Salafism. Unfortunately, our government, the United States of America, my government, I'm an American, and the West, is supporting either indirectly or I wouldn't say covertly. I mean, they are doing it in the daylight. They continue to pander these Gulf states of Saudi Arabia, Bahrain, Qatar, United Arab Emirates, who are just Kosovo. Last Sunday, this Carlota Gall wrote a detailed analysis of Kosovo, a country which got rid of Serbian oppression and became a republic by the help of the United States. Bill Clinton is the one who was a major part of that liberation of Kosovo. As soon they liberated themselves from the Serbs, they became victim of the Saudi and the Wahhabi. And then this. So this is the situation down the ground. So I'll stop here. And I will be more than happy to join Rabbi in taking the questions.
If you don't mind, if you have any questions to me, let's ask them first, because after that I'm going to need to leave. And then maybe you could ask Sheikh Agha Jafri his questions. Yes, if you have any questions for me. Yes.
Hi, my name is Sarah.
So we can hear you. You want to pass it?
Hi, my name is Sarah, and I'm Jordanian American. I was recently living in Jordan, and I noticed there that there's a lot of
Sarah, thank you for your question. You know, Sarah is a biblical name. Sarah was the first matriarch of the Jewish people. So that's beautiful to have you here today. Unfortunately, there is a lot of ignorance in many of the countries of the Middle East, and many of them are influenced by propaganda. And that poisons the well, so to speak, of the relationships between two people and two nations. You have cartoons, you have children's Sesame Street in Ramallah and in other countries where they depict the Jew as malevolent, malicious, evil, and all of those things. So when a kid at age two, his mother, as the mother nurses that kid, sings him or her songs to hate the Jews, to kill the Jews, that the Jews are pigs and apes and things like that, it's very, very difficult. And that's why a Jew will feel very uncomfortable. I think, how can we resolve that issue? In several ways. First, stop any of that incitement. The leadership of all of those countries, they have to understand, because truthfully, I think the leaders themselves don't believe that. They just like to feed their people that, because they will have a cause for those leaders to maintain themselves in power. They will always have an outside enemy. Because if there is no outside enemy, usually the population will turn upon the internal leader who has been there for years, decades, oppressing the nation, right? And so therefore he becomes the enemy. So the leaders take advantage of always having an outside enemy, the Jew, right? And so therefore, whenever there is problems inside, either economy, poverty, famine, political discord, immediately let's blame the Jews. And so that incitement has to be stopped. It has to be stopped. Secondly, in the educational process, in school, I think if there is curriculum to teach good neighborliness, we have Israel, who is either on our north, our south, our east, our west, and participate and have people make trip to Israel. Jordanians are very much welcome and some of them do come to Israel and they see what a beautiful country it is. It's a democratic country, it's an open society, everybody has equal rights. In the Knesset there is 12 to 13 Arab members of Knesset, Christian Arabs, Muslim Arabs, Shia or Sunni, doesn't matter what it is. And yet, it's interesting that some members of Knesset, the Arab members of Knesset, they don't even believe in the legitimacy of Israel. So how could they not believe in the legitimacy, yet they are members of government? It's like not believing in their own government that they represent. So it shows you how ironic the situation is. That is, unfortunately, there's a lot of propaganda. That propaganda has to be stopped. Incitement has to be stopped. Education in the children has to be stopped. And that is only the way that you could create friendliness, good neighborliness, and peace. Egypt, I think it's starting. Egypt under Mubarak, even though there was a peace, but it was a peace between him and Israel, whatever was convenient for him, tell you the truth, and his family, and his socioeconomic friends. But at the level of the nation, he never taught his people to love Israel or to be good friendly with Israel or to respect that. Now Al-Sisi thing is doing better. He's allowing in TV and the media programs that are neutral about Jews and Israel, and some of them are even positive. And that's, I think, is the first step to educate a whole people. Again, it's due to ignorance, because people just hear propaganda and 99% of those are not true. So if they come and visit, if the leaders will allow normal education without incitement, hopefully that will become peaceful coexistence. And I think if there is peace in the Middle East, that entire region would supersede Europe and even the United States. Because alone Israel has become now in the top 10 countries in the world, almost in everything. So Israel would like to share that wealth of knowledge, technology with the neighbors. Just hopefully we pray to Allah and to God that he can open up the heads and the brains of the leadership there, religious and political leadership, to see the benefit of good neighborliness. Thank you. Yes. Thank you.
I'd like to ask you a question about
Yeah.
Anti-Semitism is going to rise in Europe more particularly in London, must be aware of the recent events of the Labour Party, which I'm ashamed of, obviously, because I'm in front of the people.
Yeah.
Why do you think anti-Semitism is suddenly raised yet in Europe, particularly the United Kingdom? And secondly, if I could ask you questions regards the emergence of BDS, particularly on the university campuses, is BDS the new anti-Zionism or anti-Semitism? How is the Jewish community going to deal with this emergence, firstly, of anti-Semitism and the emergence of BDS?
Thank you for your question again. It's most welcome to have you here and pleasure to see you again. Unfortunately, anti-Semitism in Europe began 1700 years ago, and it hasn't ended. It has had its ups and downs, so it's nothing new. Unfortunately, when Constantine turned the Roman Empire into a Christian Catholic empire, that's where anti-Semitism began. And unfortunately, the teaching of the church throughout all these centuries and millennia were, again, incitement against the Jewish people and against the Jewish religion. So that created deep, deep roots of anti-Semitism in Europe. The Inquisitions, the pogroms, the Holocaust, they were all basically very fertile because there is a fertile ground of anti-Semitism. I submit to you that had Europe, had the church not instilled so much anti-Semitism throughout 1700 years, the Holocaust could not have happened. Because the Holocaust, Hitler and his regime found fertile ground in the Ukraine, in Poland, in many of those countries that the church was very, very strong. And in fact, in the Ukraine, no German army did anything to the Jews there. It was all the Ukrainian army and the Ukrainian population. And in Poland, similarly. And so there was a fertile ground. What happened was, because of the Holocaust, then the Europeans said, mea culpa, we are guilty. We did something terrible, a genocide against 6 million Jews. And they tried to change their ways, and they tried to legislate against anti-Semitism, and they did. But unfortunately, human mind is very short, memory is very short. And so we now, 70 years after, back again, anti-Semitism rears its ugly head again and again and again, because the source has not yet been eliminated completely. And then add to that the conflict in the Middle East with misinformation, incitement, and propaganda that is not true. So it just becomes another fertile ground to do so. BDS is nothing but anti-Semitism. It's not even anti-Zionism. It's just a veil for people to hide into, oh no, we're not anti-Jewish, we're just anti-Israel in policies. It's not true. Why it's not true? Because the BDS groups on campuses in the United States are attacking Jewish students, students that may have never been in Israel, students that may not be Zionist either. They're not Israelis, they're Jews, American Jews, yet they're being attacked. They're being attacked for their religion. So it's not really anti-Zionism, it's anti-Semitism with a different facade, unfortunately. And there was, if you could Google Ami Horowitz, a gentleman who did two small videos to show the situation, unfortunately. One video, actually three. One video, he took an ISIS flag on campus of one of the major universities in the United States, and he waved, join ISIS, support ISIS. And people were passed, oh, very nice, very nice. No comments about the atrocities that ISIS is doing. Nothing at all. The next day, he took a flag of Israel, and he waved it, right? And everybody, oh, that's terrible, you're a genocidal, you're this, you're that, you know. You see the reaction, he says, it's impossible, this is irrational. This is irrational, people are supporting ISIS when it's beheading people, killing people, forcing Jews, Christian, and Muslims themselves, they're killing, and yet, The students at university, oh, very nice, that's nice. When Israel comes, which is a democratic country, respects and everything, that the third video, that just came out this week, actually, of Ami Horowitz. Google him. It was a video he went with a placard saying, I am a member of the American Friends of Hamas. He says, and I'm collecting money so I could kill Jews in theaters, so I could kill Jews in cafes, in hospitals, men, women, and children. That is my purpose. I'm collecting money to do so. People were giving money. $5, $20, you know. Of course, yeah, we will join your cause. Even somebody said, no, I've been thinking about that for a long time. I'm glad I met you so I could do something about it. This was, he was not hiding behind any, he was saying specifically, I am a member of the American Friends of Hamas and my purpose is to collect money so I could kill as many Jews as I can. And people are giving money. And that's not BDS, that's clear anti-Semitism. Again, unfortunately, the ugly head of anti-Semitism still exists because of 2,000 years of church teaching and some other teachings, unfortunately. Now, nobody would want to be a Jew under these circumstances, right? But that's not the case, because we always say, Bechol dor vador, in every generation, some hateful enemy rises up to eliminate us, and God saves us from them. The Jews have been around for 3,400 years. If we count from Abraham, it's 4,000 years. All other empires, the Babylonian, the Persians, the Akkadians, the Greeks, the Romans, the Spanish, the Germans, all other empires have risen and fallen and disappeared. We're still around. So no matter how animosity we have our God who protects us and will make us successful. No other nation in the world was 2,000 years in exile, was able to revive, rejuvenate, recreates, go back to their land, establish sovereignty, and make one of the most successful countries in the history of the world. That is Israel. So we have to believe that God is with us, that He's protecting us, notwithstanding all the challenges that we have. Yes. Oh boy, I have to go. Yes. Okay, so to check.
Just before the rabbi
thank
leaves.
Thank you very, very much. Please Mark. Feel at home. And hopefully we'll see you on your next trip to the time.
Mark, just before the rabbi leaves, I want to say something.
Yes.
Rabbi. The sister Sarah and the sister from Europe asked this question as to how we can.
Yes.
I mean, you listed the problems, you know.
Yes, yeah.
But what's the solutions, you know? I think
education,
okay? Then we gotta have, sister, we gotta have seminars, we have conferences, we have education sessions like these brothers are doing, you know, all across the world. To enlighten people and educate people. That's what
yes.
I ask with Safra,
yes.
Synagogue, you should really, Safra, an organization, this should collaborate with the IC.
You're welcome at any time, any moment
important.
Of the year, this is your place.
Absolutely.
Please feel at home. Ahlan wa sahlan, shukran.
Thank you.
Tada rabba and shalom to everyone. Shalom to everyone.
Let's take a photo.
Yes, oh, of course, yes. Let's take a photo, sure. Shalom.
Representative of, as Mark said, Abraham religion. Well, I'm not a clergyman, I'm not appointed for clergy service, religious service, but as I do work for Tapan Museum, which means Ark, we meant Noah's Ark, so this is Tapan Museum, and this is the house for every nation who went out from the Ark. And I do have some background in theology. I would love to express just several words about Christianity and main principles, my brother. I am Ashot, I'm Armenian from Russia. You know, now in the 21st century we have open borders and everybody wants to live somewhere and
Can we just take some questions and then you do that? Because some people may have to leave. Should I take the questions first and then we speak, have this gentleman? Up to you, Mark.
Okay, that's okay. If you...
Okay.
Okay. Just several words about Christianity. Yes, really, Christianity comes also from the Abraham. And the main difference from Jewish religion is that Christians accept the Christ who was expected by Jews as well, but he wasn't accepted as God. So Christians believe that there is Holy Trinity, Father, Son, and the Holy Spirit, which is the united God who our brothers call Allah, Christians call God, Holy Trinity, and that's all. But the only difference is the love. The only difference is the behavior. The only difference is the salvation, and the way of salvation. And Christians believe that we will have resurrection and revelation. So this is the difference of other religions. Concerning cultural diplomacy, what I would like to say. Christians believe that the love is the ruler. It should be the ruler at least. And when we think on peace, when we desire of peace, the peace happens only when the love exists. When I can come to my brother from Islamic State, from Muslim...
Not Islam, Islam.
Okay,
Muslim,
not, Muslim not official Islamic State, some Islamic
no, I mean
government.
Islamic State, the Daesh.
Not politically, not nowadays understanding. Muslim country, okay, it's correct. Some Muslim country, Jewish country, or Jewish representative from another government or other country, we should approach with love. We should express our respect to them. So this is the only way of cultural diplomacy. And in the background, in the roots, we do have different cultures. When we don't respect other cultures, our emotions rise. When we don't respect other religions, our emotions rise. And our rabbi has mentioned about the Jewish genocide and about the Holocaust. When people don't respect other cultures, genocides happen, as it happened before Holocaust in 1915, like for Armenians, made by Ottoman Turkey. It happens every time when one nation thinks that he prevails, he is better than the other one. Never. God created us equal. So this is the main value. We are equal, we are brothers, and we should only be different with the, I guess, highest level of love expression, respect expression, our peaceful culture. So this is what I wanted to say, and thank you, we're open for questions. If you wanna add something or have questions, you're welcome.
Hello, my name is Stephen. I'm from Dallas, well, I'm coming from a Catholic background, because I was trained in Barcelona. I'm a person as a journalist, I'm a person I like to debate, I like to talk to people, I have Jewish friends, I have Jewish friends. But we are doing a very common mistake. When we are talking about, or we are having...
Is this a question?
Yeah, wait a minute.
No, is this a question?
Yes.
Well, he was before you, that brother over there. Let him ask the question first. That brother was before you.
Do you want to go before me?
Yeah, he was. He raised his hand. Let him ask the question.
Okay. So, this is not problem. This is my friend. Okay.
No, I don't mean. I didn't say he's your enemy.
Just before we're here, if our distinguished friend can speak to the Sheikh, I don't know if he's name. You can pronounce his word about this.
No problem.
How do you see the solution or avenues of reconciliation between the two mainstreams, at least the two mainstreams of Shias and Sunnis? Do you see any? Are there any points where real reconciliation between the differences could happen, potentially could point to a more peaceful future between both. I mean, I'm talking about real stuff.
Okay. Right? Yeah.
Because we know that most of us here are moderates.
Mm-hmm.
And a lot of those guys are more and more extremist, even
yes.
Natural place like this.
Yeah.
So I want to hear from you your honest, genuine opinion.
Sure.
This could
absolutely.
In the near future, even
yes.
In the future.
Okay. Yeah.
Thank you
very much. Your question. I'm a Muslim who was raised in a Muslim country. It's Pakistan. Before that, it was in India, and I lived, traveled through the Middle East, various parts. I described to you in Islam in a real sense, even though it's known. The split in Islam, or the sects in Islam, known as Shia and Sunni, but the bigger picture, the real in-depth analysis tells you that there are five schools, okay? Yeah, it's more complicated than just Shia and Sunni, and those five schools are Hanbali, Shafi'i, Maliki, Hanafi, and Jafri. Jafri or Shia, other four are Sunni. A lot of Sunni school practice things identical to what Shia do. And some Sunni school do diagonally opposite in terms of rituals. I'm talking about the prayers, like holding your hand or holding Maliki, put their hand down just like Shia do. So it's more complicated than that. Now that is the physical the difference, are some of the physical aspects of the worshiping and rituals and belief. It's the same Quran. It's the same requirements as fasting 30 days a year. Hajj, the pilgrimage to Mecca, the zakat and the tenets which are of Islam are the same, exactly the same. Now you say, then if everything is the same, then what is this problem? Why this mayhem and bloodshed and destruction? Very simple. When I was growing up, and as I see around in my adolescence and even my old age now, the real problem is not Sunni and Shia. It's not. Okay. Then you're going to say, well, then what's the problem if it's not Sunni and Shia? Unfortunately, the extreme element in each sect, whether it's Shia or Sunni. I'm a Shia, but I'm not going to sit here and defend that Shias are all sweet and sorrowful and Sunni are the villains. No, I'm not going to do that. That's not our mission here. The problem is here that the extreme elements in each sect, they create the problem. And they incite the violence, and they do this thing. Now, for example, this Daesh, this ISIS, the so-called, we call them Daesh, it's an acronym in Arabic, and Taliban, and Al-Shabaab in Africa, Boko Haram in Nigeria, Al-Qaeda in all over the world, and Al-Nusra, all these bloodsuckers and bloodthirsty people who are roaming around. They did not fall from the sky. They are part of an extremist ideology and thinking of one of the two sects. You understand that?
Yes.
So that is the problem. So it's the way they interpret Islam. They claim themselves to be Muslim. They interpret Islam the way they are being taught, and that's where the problem for education comes. They go to these mosques and these madrasas, and they get the education from there. And nothing has been done. Either by the respective governments or by us, the Western powers, the United States, Great Britain, France, Germany, and so on and so forth. We have not done anything to curtail that root cause. I talked about the Salafism, I talked about the Wahhabism, who believes that nobody has a right to live on this planet unless they are Salafi or they are Wahhabi. Be that the Christian, Jews, Shia, Hanafi, Maliki, Hanbali, anybody else, nobody. They all have to become them, what they are. And that's not going to happen. You know that. The only thing we can do, my friend, is to create that climate, even it's in a, it's a dream, or it's a mission. It should be a mission of everybody. In this universe, to do something to stop those extremist elements. You see, our fight is with the people who want to die, who are willing to die, and we want to live. It's a tough fight. It's a difficult dance. And that's what, to do that, and obviously there's no cookbook solution. There's nothing easy to solve this problem. So the best thing we should do is to find ways and means, and this is one of the means of doing this, what we're doing here. Mark and his group, and Rabbi, who's not here, you know, is to really find ways and means. It's a trial by error. I'm involved in a lot of organizations with my Sunni brothers, okay, who are as much victim of this Wahhabi and Salafi. This is a poison. This is a cancer which is eating up, not just the Muslims, but the entire humanity. Because these people are crazy. They just cannot, and I'm not going to say all Sunnis are Wahhabis and all Sunnis are Salafis. I'm not going to say that. There are 1.5 billion Muslims, of which about 250 million are Shia, and the rest are Sunni, okay? And they are, and I would say 95% of the Sunnis have got absolutely no interest. They abhor Wahhabi and Salafi teachings and all that. So you know, it's just amazing that how is such a small cult has been able to poison the well of this peaceful world. So there's no, brother. I wish I could tell you. There's no easy solution to this thing. It is gonna be very, very tough road. Yeah, because you are fighting with the people who wanna die. Okay, they don't wanna live, they wanna die. Whatever they want, they get whatever, you know, satisfaction they get, that's the problem.
Okay,
yeah, you last. Exactly.
Do you see, just very briefly, do you see any chance at the higher rank of theological thinkers, let's say the think tank of Islam?
Yes. Yeah, and I do.
Of middle ground.
Yes, yes.
In order that theologically,
yes,
basically,
yes,
there could be ways through which they could.
Yes. Indeed, yes, yes. Let me explain to you. Like Christianity, you had schism in Christianity, you had split in Christianity, the Protestant and the Catholic, and they had wars, incursions, and hundreds and thousands of people were killed. But there came a day where the Christians decided that we can agree to disagree. And there's a peace in the Christian world. I mean, here and there you hear about little skirmishes, and that's not a big problem. But there is a sort of a overall tacit understanding between the Christian sects, and they have learned to live in peace. Same thing will happen to Islam and to the Muslims. Okay, now you know that the real Sunni school, the center of the Sunni school, is Jamal Azhar in Cairo. Jamal Azhar is the oldest Sunni institution, okay, in Cairo, and of course there are some other in Damascus. And in Baghdad, there are major schools. In Karbala and Najaf, there are Shia, you know, what you call clergy, highest, the Ayatollah and the Mufti and the Imams of the highest caliber, the Faqih, we call them, Faqih, you know. These people are meeting, they are discussing, even some of the rulers, which have been more selfish and self-aggrandizing, you know, they have gotten together. This guy, Abdullah of Jordan, she talked about Jordan, he held a conference about 5 years ago in which he got all the sects of Islam together and they issue a decree, a fatwa, in which they said that there is no reason to fight for us. So yes, in answer to your question, yes, those efforts are being made on a very higher level, both on part of the clergy, on part of the governments and all that, to solve this problem, because they know that one group cannot overtake the other group. It's impossible. The politics of the situation is such, and the dynamics of whatever the current warfare is such, nobody can win. It has to be a solution, a political solution, a religious solution, and a peaceful solution. So it will happen when, of course, I don't have the crystal ball.
Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Nice.
Yes, ma'am.
Yeah.
You go.
Yeah.
No, yeah. You are your friend.
But
I'm your friend. Go ahead.
Throw this one in point.
Okay, as I said, for example, I grow up in a Catholic atmosphere, let's say. And yeah, I have religious friends, Jewish friends, Christian friends. I have a friend also from within Buddha. But I have a question, because sometimes I am involved so very often. They are nice events, they are always inspiring and respectful. But I have a question, sometimes we forgot, and I feel identified from that sense, with another actor. Of course, here we had a Muslim, Christian, and the Jew before, but we forgot a very important actor that, in my opinion, can play have a key role, you know, in helping to solve these problems, that they are the non-believers. So, and sometimes we forgot about them. Some people they call them anarchists, some people they call them free-minded.
Atheist,
yeah,
agnostic.
Yeah, so just non-believers. So, for example, using a tool as cultural diplomacy, because sometimes they are conflicts as well. My question is in two parts, but maybe the other one is very brief. Is how do you expect cultural diplomacy can be used in order to create bridges between the believers and the non-believers? How do you consider, because there is also a big conflict between these two sectors. And the other one is like, yeah, if you're agreeing with them, that sometimes in order to move forward, to solve the problems, you know, we have to start from the point that sometimes religion should be seen more as a problem, as a solution to the problem.
So you're making a statement. Are you making a statement?
Yeah, I am asking if you're in the
I have a
as the problem,
yeah,
as a solution.
I have a very, very simple response to you, brother. As long as the people who call themselves non-believers, okay, have the same right to be respected as the people who are believers. Quran said it, قُلْ يَا أَيُّهَا الْكَافِرُونَ لَعَابَدُوا مَا تَعْبُدُونَ وَلَعَنْتُمْ عَابِدُونَ مَعَابُدْ لَكُمْ دِينَكُمْ وَلِيَدِينَ. Your religion is for you and my religion is for me. Okay, and no لَا كَرَحَ فِي الدِّينَ, no compulsion in any religion. There is absolutely no, I have not heard of a war, brother, between believers and non-believers, the way with the war going on among believers. There's more wars and there's more bloodshed amongst believers. I have not heard recently or in past time that there has been a real war or bloodshed between non-believers. So our world is peaceful, leave it there. There is I don't think there is any problem between the non-believers and believers. Each as long as each respect, okay? As a Muslim, I can tell you, there's nothing, you know, it says that you don't say nothing. I cannot recite you the Qur'ani ayah. It says that you should not say anything to anybody about his or her religion. Bad. Anything bad about his or her religion. Because he or she will react to you and the sin would be yours. Not his, because you are the one who instigated it and you initiated it. So as a Muslim, I can tell you, I have no right, whether you are a believer or non-believer, I have no right to criticize or question your aqidah, your faith. That's what the Muslims should
do. Well, we can criticize, but I love a sentence of Voltaire that says, I am not agree with you at all, or maybe nothing, but
that's the same thing.
I will kill in order that you have the chance just to defend your ideas.
Mm-hmm.
But we have the chance always to criticize.
We should discuss that debate. We should debate, and but to really bring a negative outcome to that debate is the bad thing. Debating, there's nothing wrong debating. That creates, it provokes intellectual curiosity, and it helps you. Debating is very good. Yes, please.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Very much. Thank you very much. How do you think the Muslim community is to deal with the issue of radicalization and violent extremism amongst Muslim youth?
Among Muslim?
Muslim young people,
mm-hmm.
Otherwise.
Yeah.
And secondly, there's tremendous emergence of Islamophobia in the region, not just here in the United States, but globally in Europe, following on from events that happened in Paris, Belgium. And thirdly, you agree that education and speaking out. I must commend you because I've been actually hosting an event in July on bringing together the three main faiths of the UN. It's going to be a conversation on uniting the world for a safe place, a conversation on radicalization, violent extremism, and hate crimes. Will discuss Islamophobia and also anti-Semitism. Now, the Muslim community seems to be a bit quiet and sort of counter this negative rhetoric that ISIS has been doing. You're the first gentleman, I must commend you on that. Because I came back from Houston recently, where I had a meeting in a mosque in Houston. I'm trying to gather together various Muslim speakers, but ISIS was like the white elephant in the room. Nobody wanted to mention it until I mentioned it, and I still didn't realize their reaction. So suddenly felt uncomfortable. But I said to my brothers, if we are to have a conversation, we have to be honest with ourselves. You can't just sit there in your comfort zone in Houston or in New York and thinking what's happening in Baghdad or in Paris or in, you know, Nigeria. I love Nigeria myself. It's not going to happen here in the United States. We have to, the whole global community is affected by this negative rhetoric which ISIS has so skillfully managed to manipulate us with its use of social media. Now, I feel that it's about time that the Muslim community comes out openly and negates this negative rhetoric and say, this is not our religion, this is not Islam. You have to get your house in order. Be you Shia, be you Sunnis, because for my event, I'm going to have Shia speakers, I'm going to have Sunni speakers, but you have to get your house in order. Because one thing you're facing, you're all facing, is this negative impression of Islam. Islam is a peaceful religion.
Thank you.
And you have to come out openly and say,
yes.
Because the ordinary man on the street here in New York, who doesn't know where Baghdad is, who doesn't know where Karachi is, who doesn't know where Maiduguri is in Nigeria, they think Islam is ISIS. And that is not true.
And they are right.
If you say to them, where is Karachi? Because I grew up in England. I have friends who are from Pakistanis or Indians who are from Afghanistan, and I know that it is not Islam. We have this problem in Nigeria. I saw the emergence of Boko Haram. They started our Majuris in the mosque. But the Nigerian government was sleeping. They thought, okay, it's happening in northern Nigeria. It's not going to come down to Enugu. It's not going to come down to Ibadan. It's not going to come down to Lagos. Well, I'm sorry, it has. Boko Haram swore allegiance to ISIS. So technically, Boko Haram is now ISIS in West Africa.
All about it.
And it will spread. The other day I spoke to an ambassador at the UN. He said, Roger, I'll come to your event, but I come from Botswana, and I don't really want to make a comment because, you know, it's not coming down to our region, but I'm sorry, you have Al-Shabaab in Kenya. As a matter of fact, soon this whole issue of terrorism will spread.
In Africa.
It's not just spread, but everybody is thinking, you know, it's just going to stick to Nigeria, Cameroon, Chad.
That's true.
It's spread from Nigeria to Cameroon to Chad to Niger. You had some incidents in Mali. You soon have it in Senegal.
Oh, yeah.
Rural community.
It's going to go into West Africa. Yeah.
Yes.
Yeah, I'm aware.
Rural community, actually, when I first contacted them 3 months ago, they were very reluctant. But now they're calling me, okay, Roger, we'll come to your event to discuss it. So basically what I'm trying to say with respect to the Muslim community has to come out and negate this negative rhetoric about Islam.
Okay, now, is this a statement or it's a question? Okay, the question is, sister, let me say to you from the depth of my heart that every single word that you uttered is a statement of fact. It saddens me as a Muslim to sit here and admit. I mean, I have a friend here, I call him a brother. His name is Boris Pinkus. He's Jewish, Bukharan Jew, from the Central Asian Republic. I'm much more closer to him than I am to a Muslim brother because he tells the truth. He does not make mechanical statement. He's honest, and when he, whatever he says, it's the voice of my heart as well. That's where we come from. There is indeed this painful fact which Muslims refuse to recognize, is that amongst us Muslims, we don't have the moxie, nor we have the mettle to admit that a 90% or 95% of the reason of this atrocity and this mayhem and this bloodshed and this genocide is being created because of Muslims. I also have a friend by the name of Stephen Schwartz. Back in 2002, he wrote a book, Two Faces of Islam. I'm going to give you a copy of that book, and you should read it. It's an excellent, it's an outstanding commentary on the on Islam in general and the Islam in the West. He is he's not well now, so he's not on the front pages and all that. But he did a masterful job in writing that book. Boris, you know that that book, Two Faces of Islam. So what I'm saying here is that in that book is so clearly delineated as to what is going on. Now, here, I told you there are about 4 or 5 million Muslims. There are organizations which are called ISNA, IKNA, CARE, MSA, okay? Shias have an organization called Ummah, but that's more like they found it as something to advance the agenda of the Shia Muslims in America, but it's fallen to the ritualism, so it's not worth mentioning. I'm not going to mention. I am a Secretary General of American Muslim Congress, a dormant organization, but mostly into things they do, write papers and research and analysis and all that. It's not what you call a civic organization, an activist organization as such, so to speak. These organizations whose name I mentioned, they are funded by Saudi Arabia, Qatar, Bahrain, Kuwait, and United Emirates, okay? And you know that these Gulf states of Saudi Arabia, Qatar, Bahrain, Kuwait, they are all Salafi states. All of them are Salafi states. Now, the madrasas in Pakistan, in India, in Nigeria, where these hundreds of poor, very poor students, African students, Asian students, Arab students, the Iranian students, not Iran, I'll keep Iran out, Iran is different. All these students are getting education in the name of Islam, are learning how to become a ISIS, a Taliban, a Boko Haram, a Daesh, most, they are taught, right? I mean, I have been to those schools. They are taught how to kill, how to massacre the Christians, how to go after Jews, how to go after Hindus, after Muslims who are Shia, who are Hanafi, who are Shia, Sunni Muslims, Maliki, Shafi'i, Hanafi Muslims, go after them. So there is the cancer in this whole thing. I cannot go to venture about any other religion because are people of any other faith, because my own people are the criminals. And you talk about a session where you sat and they would not mention ISIS? Sister, these people are supporting, they are financing ISIS. You talk about them mentioning it? Oh, of course, they love to make mechanical statement. Islam is a religion of peace. That's a lot of hogwash. Islam, of course, is a religion of peace. We are talking about Muslims. You, what? Kosovo, a little country of 1.8 million people. Look what they did to Kosovo. I mean, they have, this Carlota Gal has done such a comprehensive analysis this past Sunday about what's happening in Kosovo. They have left out Africa, as you said. They have invaded full-fledged. Wall Street did a piece, and as to how ISIS have infiltrated into Uyghur. And we have, by the way, if you think I'm speaking on the top of my head, okay, I cannot help it, but we have documentary evidence that ISIS, Taliban, Al-Qaeda, Al-Shabaab, and all these cannibal organizations are simple, mere mercenaries of these Gulf states, whom we are supporting, the Western powers are supporting. We are ignoring them, we are denying the fact that the problem of the roots of the problem are these states who are supporting the finance. We have more than documentary evidence. Then we can say that they are people. Why can't we stop? Why can't we treat Saudi Arabia and Qatar and Bahrain like we treated Cuba, like we treated Iran, Islamic Republic of Iran, like we treat North Korea? Why can't we treat these countries like that? Why are we pandering them? What is the reason? So we are at fault also, my sister. We are at a great difficulty. So we have to, of course, Saudi Arabia has got $1.2 trillion in our financial institutions. So we are very, you know, forget about it, to add insult to injury, you know about these 28 pages. You know about as to what happened about this 9/11 commission, which took place after the tragedy of September 1, 2011. You know what happened. After the tragedy, a commission was established. Senators Graham of Florida and Kerry of Nebraska sat down and they found out that there was a direct involvement between the 9/11 and Saudi Arabia and some other countries. But we are holding those 28 pages. Senate unanimously approved the bill last week, saying that there is a connection, and as such, all the families of the victims of 9/11 have a right to make claims against this government. President is going to probably veto it, and most likely that veto would be overridden. That is destroying that. But I cannot agree with you anymore. What you said is the truth. These Muslim leaders must be told very bluntly, and that's why I am despised. I am disliked. I am cut out from some of these sessions Because I say these things, they say, why you say these things, brother? You're a Muslim. You're supposed to defend Islam. What are you doing this thing for? I said, but I cannot lie. I cannot cover up. I cannot be a hypocrite. This is being done in the name of Islam. You tell me that I should lie, I should make statements to please somebody? No, we have to please Allah, God. That's what we have to do. So this music is not going to stop until we come to realize, and I'm talking about Western powers, we have to come to grip with this fact that we have to treat Saudi Arabia and Qatar and Bahrain and Kuwait and United Arab Emirates in the same way we treated Cuba, Islamic Republic of Iran and North Korea. And that is the only way, and we must stop pandering them. We stop providing them shelter, okay, from their enemies, okay. They have to learn why cannot Saudi Arabia become friendly with Iran? Why cannot Saudi Arabia become friendly with Iran? Okay, there will be no problem. There will be no issue of Shia and Sunni. There will be no issue Saudi Arabia wants to become a regional power. Okay, become a regional power. There's nothing wrong. But stop this brand of Islam, the cult you are spreading, which creates hatred, hate speech, and mayhems and massacres. No problem. Okay, but get no. We don't, Iran is this. Iran is that. This country is this. This country is that. That has to stop. And that's what we have to do. So in answer to your question, all the problems are there. They're going to be there, okay, until and unless we tackle that. That's right. I hope I answered your question.
Yeah. Just to add something, just several sentences. I don't think that most issues that derive in the world are connected in the roots with any religion. Mostly the problem is our understanding of truth. Mostly we have problem of real judgment. But the best thing is not to judge. When we start already to judge that this is Muslim, this is Christian, this is this kind of Christian, this is that kind of Christian, this is that kind of Muslim, problems derive. Our problem is inner human being. It's in ourselves. Even in our families, even in our societies, even in our countries, even in our inner religions, we start blaming each other, stamping each other, giving names, discussing the other's behavior, but we don't look inside, we don't look into our hearts. The same is going outside. The same is going outside in the state, in the government, in the country. Be it United States, I don't know, Israel, Armenia, Russia, Germany, Italy, it doesn't matter. When a human being starts blaming the others, despite looking inside of his own behavior, soul, the result will be the same. And the second thing I would like to add, look at the results. It doesn't matter. It's Shia, Sunni, Orthodox, Catholic, I don't know, Jewish Orthodox, it doesn't matter. We should look at the results, as the fruit, we say, yeah? In all of our religions, I believe, in our cultures, we do have the same expression. The tree is known of its fruits. So look at fruits. Pay attention at fruits. Are they peaceful? Or not, I'm crying out about peace, but I start killing tomorrow. I'm crying out about love, but I start hating everybody tomorrow. So what's the truth? We have this brain, we have this understanding as human beings, so let's start to use our understanding of the truth and the justice. Don't kill yourself by killing your feelings, by killing your judgment. Thank you. Yeah. And then?
Excuse me, brother. I hope you didn't think I was particularly pinpointed in Islam. Now, the reason I ask you that question, brother, is because, as I explained to you, I've hosted the event, and I've been trying to interview leaders from the three main faiths. I'm having a panel discussion at the UN in July, and there are leaders from the Muslim community, the Jewish community, and the Christian community. Now, I'm having great difficulty getting leaders from the Muslim community to speak the truth like you have. I'm not picking any particular religion.
Thank
I'm
you.
Not saying Islam is not a religion.
Thank you.
Yeah.
No, you're right.
Okay,
and you're right. And you're
I'm
right.
Having a conversation, which is the first time I've done that at the UN, in which we will ask questions. We're going to have a question and answer session from the audience. You may face questions that you may not want to answer. I spoke with an evangelical priest 2 weeks ago when he was at Fox News. The first question he said to me was, what religion are you? Are you Muslim, are you Jew, or are you Christian? Then when he began to relax and he started, I had an interview with him, he said he wants to come to the panel discussion. The first thing he said to me is, I hate Muslims. So I said to him, Pastor, man, your position, how can you say that?
Yeah.
I said, okay, Pastor, you were
that's
a confidential candidate to come to this discussion. So that you can sit next to a Muslim and you can explain to him why you hate it.
Absolutely.
You understand my point? So don't think I'm picking on any religion.
No, no, no.
I'm an attorney,
I'm a professional.
Let me add on. I can defend anyone. I can defend the devil.
Of course.
You understand my point?
No, you...
I don't take sides.
Sister, I said that. Let me have that before. I said that.
Criticize a lot of the media.
You, whatever you told, whatever you said, your question as well as your narrative, was nothing but the truth. Okay, I have absolutely. It was sincere. It was sincere. And I have no problem with
it. For you to admit it or deny it.
Exactly.
I'm a moderator. I am.
And we are not admitting.
No, we are.
We are not admitting. That's the problem. Yes, you should.
Like
I would love to attend that discussion.
I'm inviting you. I specifically came today because I wanted to talk to you. To invite you to speak.
Thank you. Thank
because
you.
Everybody else, all the Muslim community leaders, they're all sort of, you know.
They hedge.
Yes, they said at the beginning, yes, we'll come forward. Houston said we'll come forward.
Yeah.
I've not seen them.
No mechanical statements.
Yes.
Speak the truth.
Forward.
Yeah.
They don't know because they know. When they come there, the cameras are loaded at the UN. So
I would love to be there.
From the audience, they put a question to them, which they cannot suddenly back off because the cameras are rolling.
Thank you.
You understand?
God bless you, God
bless you. They know, when I was at an event in 2014 on anti-Semitism, I was the most hated person in New York. You understand my point?
God bless you.
Because why would you hold an event in anti-Semitism? Whatever the persecution of Christians in the Middle East, yes, you're correct, brother. Saudi Arabia, most of these Gulf states, said abortion, remove that word in the Middle East.
You know something? I just blogged on something. They had an article in the New York Times. Let me tell you this thing very interesting. You know, they had an article in the New York Times that a community, some township in New Jersey, refused to build a mosque. Okay, and the Muslims are up in the arms about that. Why do you refuse to build a mosque in the neighborhood? Okay, and they had plausible reasons. They had logical reasons. There was a residential area, and they say you cannot have it here. You cannot have it here. You cannot have it there. Okay, so listen to this one.
Let's pause there and until you are asked.
The mosque. So I said to them, the Christians, and the Jews and the Hindus, forget about a place of worship. They cannot worship in Saudi Arabia. If they are in Saudi Arabia, in Kuwait, in Bahrain, in Dubai, in Qatar, and certain Muslim people, they cannot even worship. Forget about getting a temple or a synagogue. How dare you question, how dare you demand from a community, which is predominantly Christian or predominantly Jewish, that we must have a mosque in their neighborhood. How dare you can say that? So I blogged it. A lot of people got after me, a lot of people complimented me for being honest and truthful, that you said you are being a hypocrite. Go and tell your governments where you are from, these Muslim organizations, whose speakers you are searching and they would refuse to come and see. I told them, why don't you ask Saudi Arabia to have a synagogue in Makkah and Medina, or in Jeddah, or in Riyadh? Why can't you have a temple, Hindu temple here or there, a church? No, won't do it. So you see the hypocrisy here? And one thing is not one thing, sister. It is 10 things which are going on. I'm saying it to you. Malcolm X, who was a Muslim, by the way, used to say, if you read his biography, there's a line in his biography, whether you use the bullets or the ballots, you got to aim well. Don't strike the puppet. Strike the puppeteer. And the puppeteer, in this case, is us here, the Western powers. They are, and these governments are puppets. They cannot do any, they don't know how to fight. We are giving them arms. ammunition, state-of-the-art ammunition. And Saudi Arabia has got a lot of money. Their budget is the third largest in the world. Okay, and that's a country of only 20 million people. It's not a tiny country; it's a large country, but it is a Salafi country. Okay, it's a Wahhabi country which is trying to create misery and mischief in the world. You know, we are selling them arms. We should not sell them arms. Canada just yesterday refused to sell them $15 billion worth of arms. We should do to them what we did to Iran, what we do to North Korea, what we did to Cuba. Hey, it's a fair play. You want to be fair? Be fair. And that's what I think we should do. The Western powers must learn to stop supporting and stop pandering these states which are creating problem. And whether we talk about a madrasa, you talk about anything, the Saudis are behind it. I'm sorry. Yes. That's good. Waalaikumsalam. How are you? This is Boris Pinkas.
I'm glad to be here today. My name is Boris Pinkas. I'm a Jew. I was born and grew up in Muslim country. I'm a son of one of the greatest rabbis who established a Jewish center in Moscow. He's originally from Jerusalem. Am I read Quran also? I'm so proud of my brother, Agha Jafri. I'm calling my brother, who helped me right after September 11. Established one of the, I think, the most impressive organization, non-for-profit organization, called Religions in Dialogue. Since that time, we face so many issues related with Jews, Christians, and Muslims. The most painful for me was Islamophobia, which was spreading not just in the United States, around the world, right after September 11. And my job was to tell the truth, Americans, who are Muslims in reality are. And I'm proud of my brother who helped me a lot, who helped me to cross the door of one of the largest Muslim schools in New York City and Razi School in Queens, and we established group which includes rabbis, imams, and priests. Our purpose was to bring this group to religious schools, which includes Muslims, Christians, and Jewish schools, and deliver lectures about our common values, values which unite us, not divide us. Therefore, any issues related to terrorism brings you to education. We never get success unless we teach our kids from childhood. My grandfather always told me, my son, if you buy a house, don't buy a house, buy a neighbor. How can we be happy, we Jews and Christians, if millions of Muslims suffering from hunger, killing each other for nothing? I will give you an example. Just a couple months ago, one couple, Christian couple, were driving in Iraq. Suddenly they were stopped by ISIS people. And one of them, ISIS man, came to the driver and said, "Are you Muslim?" He said, "Yes, I'm Muslim." "How can you prove? Can you tell me something from Quran?" And he started reading something from Bible. And this guy from ISIS said, "Oh, you great man, go ahead." And when they left, wife said, "Are you crazy? You read the Bible, not Quran." He said, "No, they are not Muslims. They don't know Quran. If they knew Quran, they never killed the people."
Yes. Very good.
Another thing is, when CNN reporter stopped 10-year-old boy and asked what his biggest dream is, he said to kill the Jew. 10 years old. What he knows about the Jew? Therefore, when we came to Razi school, and rabbi who came with us, priest, delivered lectures about our common values. Imagine kids from 8 to 18 years old were so impressed. They never ever heard that Abraham is a father of Jews also. They never heard that halal and kosher food is allowed to eat Muslims also. Many, many things which were new for kids. Then we brought them to our Jewish Heritage Museum. They first time in their life attended in Holocaust program. They never heard that Jews were killed by Nazi Germans just because of their Jews. Who will tell them? We are responsible for everything what happened in this world, each of us. Nobody can help us unless we help ourselves. I teach my kids about Islam. When they watch TV, they watch CNN, Fox News, seeing how people killed by just because of their Christians. By the way, you know how many Christians were killed during last decades? That just because they are Christians, over 20,000 just during last decade. Have we ever heard this talk about in the United Nations or in the European Union or even in Barack Obama administrations? It's never happened. Like Christians don't exist. Therefore, it's very serious. Not because of ISIS or Boko Haram or others. Because of who we are. We keep ourselves outside from the issues. We say, I don't care. It doesn't touch my family. It's wrong. It will touch tomorrow. Therefore, my purpose is now, first of all, I'm so proud of my friend who initiated this event. And we have to continue. We have to join. I will tell you, we have amazing experience with my brother. We're part of one of the largest non-for-profit organizations called Homes de Parole, based in Paris. We initiated, attended in many events in different parts of the European countries. It stopped now for a while, for many reasons, because our main purpose is to have security. Government, local government should provide us first of all by security, then we have to act. Therefore, I hope we will continue working on these issues. At the same time, we should not be quiet in the United States. Unfortunately, I'm asking each of you, have you ever seen any Muslims rally on Fifth Avenue against terrorism? No. Have you ever seen any Muslims, prominent person, who are on TV condemning Muslim radicals? No. And we have to help them how to defend their own values. Most of Jews even don't know that Muslims saved millions of lives of Jews during 14th, 15th, 16th centuries. During World War II, millions of Jews have refuge had in Turkey, in Libya, in Iraq. This is part of education which must be delivered in each schools, not only in religious schools, even in public schools. We cannot do it if we are not united. We have to tell the truth. Thank you for your attention. I hope we will continue our discussions and dialogues. Thank you, my brother.
Thank you. Any other questions? Please. Yes.
Hi, thank you very much for that. I fully agree with everything that you said for the most part. Definitely unity. There were a few things that I, for the most part, also agree with you, Chef, but there are a few things that I want to disagree with. First of all, that the solution to all this ISIS crap is with our leaders over in the Middle East or over here. In my opinion, when we sit and we wait for the leaders to make a change, we're going to be sitting here forever. very outgoing, open-minded girl, lots of friends from different religions and things like that. And I found out that she considered herself an ISIS supporter. And I was shocked because her personality and her character didn't really go with that. When I asked her, she said basically that she was afraid to say that she wasn't on the side of an Islamic state. In other words, because they said that they're Islamic, she was afraid to go against it. Like they're using the word Islam against people. So some Muslims are in fear to say that they're not supporting an Islamic state. So what I showed her was a video of a group of British imams. I'm not sure if they were all from England, but they were all from the UK. And they put together a video about ISIS and, you know, preaching and speaking out against them. And when she saw that video, she was relieved. And she's like, oh, okay, well, if the scholars are telling us it's okay, then all right, you know, I have somebody to depend on. So I feel like Muslim scholars have a very big responsibility to do something like those British scholars. And you mentioned, like, do you see in the news that they're speaking out against ISIS? No, you don't, because for some reason those videos aren't getting very popular. You know, it's very sad that the media isn't showing this side of Islam, but these people were speaking out. But, you know, that video, when I saw it, it was, you know, aimed at the youth. And I think we need more of that, and I think it needs to gain popularity. So, yes, I have seen people speaking out, but I haven't seen it on media. I've seen it, you know, on major outlets. I have not seen it. I saw it because it was being shared on some of the groups that I'm following on Facebook. So it definitely needs to get traction. Another thing, you know, when you said that Saudi Arabia isn't allowing, they don't allow anyone into Mecca, for example, unless they're Muslim, which I think is awful.
Prophet did. The Prophet allowed everybody.
The Prophet did, of course. There's so much hypocrisy. But besides the fact that they don't allow synagogues or churches to be built, I don't think we should apply that in the U.S. or anywhere else.
No.
I think it's wonderful. Yeah. But it's wonderful that we're living in a place where we can worship together in the same town. We can have synagogues and churches and mosques together. There's actually an initiative that I was talking to my colleagues about in Berlin. It's called House of One, and it's a church, a synagogue, and a mosque in one building. They're building it now. So I think things like that are great, and those are the kinds of things that we need to show people, like, a lot of people are just ignorant. They don't realize, like, we're so similar, and we can worship together, and we can all be together, and it's all great, you know? And we need the scholars to speak out about ISIS, I think, because just the last thing is, like, Islam, what I noticed in the Middle East, people have stopped referring to the Quran. They're now referring to the scholars. And they're being told that they can't interpret the Quran on their own. They need somebody to explain it to them. A lot of the Arab scholars are afraid to speak out against ISIS because they're right there in the area. You know?
They're what?
They're in the area where ISIS is.
Oh,
afraid.
So they're afraid.
No, she referred to the Muslims here in the United States.
The ones here in the U.S. and the U.K., they're, you know, the Muslim majority is not Arab.
I understand that, yeah.
So I would really like if the scholars and people like you could put out videos there and try to get on these places like Fox News, where I have to listen to that, by the way.
I asked you.
Let me first
give you a disclaimer to you, Sister Sarah, about the mosque in Jersey. I didn't say that because you know, I don't want to incite the neighborhood in some township. Certain, I will not name the name of the township. This is very Jewish.
Highland Park?
Highland Park, I said. It's just primarily Jewish. So Jews did not oppose the mosque. Did not oppose the mosque at all.
No.
They said, this is a residential neighborhood. Okay? Please, can you, instead of here, how about a few blocks from here? That's all they said. Damn Jews, these damn Zionists, you know, they are against Muslim, it's Islamophobia. But when I infer the example of the masjid. They cannot have a prophet of Islam, have Jews and Christians together. He socialized with them, got together with them. He had feasted with them. He treated them equally. There was absolutely no difference. What I meant is that just because Saudi Arabia does not allow, our government should have the same policy. No, I didn't mean that at all. What I meant is that our Muslim leaders to incite the community wrongfully to say, because Jews are the one who are trying to stop. There was not an issue at all. Jews did not, we live in a pluralistic society. United States government, constitution, we live with the constitution. Constitution forbids any such discrimination against any faith. So we don't have to worry about that. No, absolutely not. We're not gonna do, you're gonna stoop to the level of Saudi Arabia under any circumstances, to any extent. I didn't mean that. I'm sorry if I left that impression. No, we are doing what we are doing. Scholars, let me tell you something more dirty. It's getting dirty, really. There are about 2,000 mosques in North America. 2,000 mosques in North America. Over 2,000 mosques in North America. About roughly 2,000, 2,200, don't quote me, but there's a number of mosques.
Yeah.
Do you know majority of them are supported by Saudi money, Saudi Arabian money? Supported by the imams in half of those mosques are trained in Saudi Arabia.
Yes.
What are you going to get from those imams? What are you going to get there? Sister, okay? And do you know, and I don't blame them. I was talking to Dan Pipes one day. We have a group of people, and we're meeting with Dan Pipes. Some of my Muslim brothers, who are very much against Dan Pipes, because Dan Pipes is considered very Islamophobic, very anti-Islam. They have a lot of, but yet they came to me, because I know Dan Pipes. He said, would you please arrange a meeting with Dan Pipes? So we went and met him here in Panem Building, the old Panem Building. We were sitting and meeting. So some of these brothers, Muslim leadership, said to him, Mr. Pipes, why are you behaving like this? Why you talk like this against Islam? Why you just think, and he heard that you suggested there should be surveillance of these mosques. So he threw these statistics, which I just gave you, okay? And then he said, given that, do you want me to ask the government of the United States to have the surveillance on Chinatown? Of course, it has to be where the problem, the fitna is being created. So he was right. He said that they, and believe me, you don't have to be a rocket scientist. Just go to the Jum'ah sermon, Friday sermons, at some of these mosques. Go. I don't know, you're a Muslim sister? You don't go to any of these mosques? Go to some mosque. I'm telling you, I'm not putting you on the spot, but I'm saying to you what I hear. I go from mosque to mosque just to listen. I'm not part of surveillance team, don't take me wrong, but I hear nothing but hate speech against Jews, against Christian, against fellow Muslims. Oh, you are not Wahhabi, you are not Salafi, you are Hanafi, or you are Shia, you are Maliki, you are Kafir, infidel, Najis. That's what we are. Does anybody know that? Does any know? It is happening in the daylight. I have seen it time and time again.
You're telling me.
And how much I'm going to hide? That's what this sister from England is referring to when she talks about these people don't want to come in the front. They don't want to be. They don't want to. What are they going to take? When you live in a glass house, how can you throw stones at us? And that is the problem. We have problem first in Islam, Muslim amongst Muslims. Because we are not honest with our Jewish brothers, with our Christian brothers, with our Hindu brothers. We are not honest with them. We are not telling them the truth. And to tell you something else, I have a friend. He was the president, he just retired of the American. Sister, you gotta listen to this one. Sister, you gotta listen to this one. I have a friend who is just the president of a largest firm. He's like a CSF, Center for Foreign Studies, or something like that. It's a large office. He said to me, Mr. Jafri, the Muslims have only one mission. So I said, what is that mission? He was joking with me, of course. He's a pretty high up guy in the US government and everything. He said, peaceful Muslims, and you have violent Muslims. I said, yeah, that's true. He said, peace-loving Muslims and violent Muslims both want to destroy every other civilization. as long as I'm Islamic. I said, is that right? How are you making it? He said, yeah, the only difference is the peace-loving one do it in a peaceful way, and the violent must do it in a violent way. That was, it's like a joke, you know, it's like a pun, you know, he was giving it to me. But sometimes I really begin to think, when she says that she is having a difficulty in finding some speakers who will come out and speak the truth, who are hedging, who are making a mechanical statement, that she's right. That is the case. I met a couple nights ago, I met some of them at this Rabbi Schneid's occasion. Two nights ago. I met these people and I said, brother, what are you doing? You're not coming out and you're not saying. They're shouting and screaming at us. The Christian world and the Jewish world, they're saying, why can't we come out and say the truth? No, you know, you have to understand. We have to go to Hajj. We have to go to Umrah. We have to go to, you know, we are, as Muslims, we are required. Hajj is a definite. Well, you know, once in a life, don't really go 10,000 times, only once in a lifetime. And Umrah, we can go, you know, that's temporary, you know, not temporary, but a shorter version of the Hajj. We're not going to travel, we're going to get killed. If we say, come on, this is what they say. These are very good brothers. They are not bad people, they are from people from Islam, from Ikhna, from Kiel. You know, you're familiar with those organizations? Yeah, these are good people, but they are scared. So there are reasons, there are factors they cannot speak up, sister. That's also, in their defense, I'm saying that. Okay, but a majority of them is not doing because of that reason. They are doing because they want to be honest. They want to be true. That's the point.
Yeah.
I hope I answered your question.
Another question is there.
You answered my question. You said they are scared. I wanted to know the motivation. Why is this the way it is? I mean, you said they're scared.
Because they have to go back to do Hajj. They have to go back to Umrah. These are the... A Muslim is not a Muslim unless he performs Hajj once in a lifetime. I will die as a non-Muslim. I did Hajj, by the way, 20 years ago, so I say I protected myself. I cannot go now, they knock me off in 2 seconds, you know. And I have no plan to do that, I'm sorry.
It's too risky.
I did a long time ago. But we are compelled to do Hajj. Umrah, no. Umrah we can go if we are... We can go. But once in a lifetime, I, Sister Sarah, and other Muslim brothers who are sitting here, they are required to do Hajj. There's no exception. And so some of these brothers, not all of them, I don't want to say that all of them have that situation. No, most of them don't have that situation. They are doing it for being politically correct. They are doing it because they are funded and financed by those governments. That's what. I'm sorry. Fabio? Yes, brother.
This is Ivan from Afghanistan. While I just kind of late to join the discussion. In Afghanistan, we also have lots of problems. The majority of the population are Muslims. So we have problems back in 2006 and 2007, while the masjids.
After the Taliban?
Yeah, after the Taliban. The scholars were giving speech which were harming the teenagers to have
hate speeches.
Yeah, to have the kind of perception that, as you have mentioned, to just do things which are not allowed in Islam. That this is how they have interpreted the university.
Sermons, so their sermons.
The government came to know, and now there's a very good system in place.
Really?
Interesting for you guys to know. The speech which are giving on Fridays,
mashallah,
during Jumas,
mashallah,
the government decides that all the mullahs should talk and we start. So
we cannot do it here, sister.
Yeah. So I think that should take place in other places.
Well, that's very good, but you only good in Afghanistan. You cannot do it here.
Yeah. So that's how that helps the community. For example, we have the different sites in every religion. But let's face it, that in most of the Middle East and Islamic countries in Asia and other places, Islam has been something like the people giving legacy. They do not go inside that to read what really Quran says or what really a Muslim should be. But what they come is, for example, broken Muslim family, his name is, for example, a Muslim name, then he pretend himself to be a Muslim. He does not go inside to read Quran in details or hadith or to see how Prophet behaved with the other religion. So I think that should be one case here. And just, I'm not sure if I'm wrong, but Hajj, as you mentioned, has its own kind of criteria. And, if I disagree that it's not must that you should go to Hajj once in a life.
As long as you can afford it. As long as you can afford it, yeah.
As long as you afford it.
Financially.
In terms that you have enough money to serve your family for a year, and then you had money in your pocket.
No, I made the statement under the assumption that anybody who can afford to must be. I mean, you know, I made the statement. I could afford it, that's why I made it.
Yeah.
And most of these people we are talking about, they can afford it.
Yeah.
Of course, you have to be able to afford it.
Yeah.
It used to be $2,000, now it's $10,000.
So most of the people who cannot afford, they do not go. Even the people who afford, they do not go. So I think...
No, it's a requirement, brother. Even what you say, people who cannot afford, they cannot go, that's not right. It's a requirement. You cannot.
I mean that there are several other, as I studied, there are several other things that you have to take care of before you go to Hajj. If you have enough money and your neighbor is dying of hunger, then it's good to give first the price to your neighbor. Then you go to Hajj.
Well, it's not my job, the mullah has to decide that. I don't have to have any comment about that. I'm going to leave it to a mullah to decide. Imam.
Okay.
Anything else? Anybody else? Any question, please? So I guess we can. Yes, brother.
My name is Rukhavish.
Will you guys come here? Yeah, brother.
My name is Rukhavish. I'm from Pakistan. I'm a man who works PhD and a biographer.
What school? What school?
Karachi University.
MashaAllah.
I've been raised in a Muslim family, but now I'm a Marxist and atheist. So, right from the beginning, I've been reading the same, like you were saying.
Okay.
For example, if you are an LGBT, you don't have the right to exist, and faith says that you don't. If you are non-believer, faith says the same Quran, you don't have the right to exist.
Okay.
If the woman do that, she shall be stoned. I puked a lot when I saw the video of one time in the Kabul which happened to Roshanga. And it was by the system, by the Islam, it happened. Because it said that.
Brother Qureshi, before you arrived, one of the brothers did ask a question. I think it was, that brother over there. Brother, your name?
My name is
Mr. Yeah, he is also same school of thought as you are. You are familiar with Quran. There is an ayah in the Quran, the surah, Surah Kafirun. Surah, Ya Ayyuhal Kafirun, La Abadu Ma Ta'abadun, Wa La Antum Abadun Wa Ma'abud. Wa La Antum Abadun Wa Ma'abud Lakum Deenakum Wa Yadeen. Allah saying, to the people through the Prophet. At the end, conclusion is that, look, whatever, you know, kafir is kafir, mu'min is mu'min, Muslim is Muslim, non-Muslim is non-Muslim. But then, however, henceforth, your religion is good for you and my religion is good for me. Idea is that person who's a non-believer or a Marxist or a agnostic or an atheist has same amount of, he or she commands, same amount of respect as a person who, like me, Sister Sarah, or these Jewish brothers and Christian brothers have in their faith, okay? There's no sense in conducting postmortem of my faith, what my Quran says. Inasmuch I attack Muslim leaders and Muslim clergy and the people who are doing wrong things for Islam, like you gave the example of ISIS. That's not a good example, brother. You gave the example of brother ISIS and all that. All these people, they are the followers. but don't attack the faith. If I'm saying that Islam is a religion of peace, it's not a mechanical statement. It is a religion of peace. You go, you study, you are a Marxist, okay? You read Das Kapital or any other book of virtues which really dominates your psyche. And that's okay with me, I have no problem. I will never attack you, I'll never disrespect. And I'm sure that Das Kapital and the books of the Marxism and all that have got flaws, have got problems, but that's not to say that the communism is wrong or Marxism is wrong. That's not my job. That's not I did it. I'm over here to defend Islam. Islam, I said. I have to defend here Islam as a faith which I believe in, which teaches like Judaism and Christianity, universal truth and justice and fairness, not to harm people, not to do this and that. Don't blame the faith for the deeds of the people, brother. Okay? Whether it is Hajj, or it's Umrah, or Salat, or fasting, whatever it is, okay? Let them do, this is their faith, their Aqidah, let them do. Leave them alone. You do what you want to do, no problem. However, when in this big tent that we live in, which is called this world, that is universe, you know, there are problems, there are issues, there are concerns like there are at any time. This is dunya. This is supposed to be very temporary. Very, very temporary. Kullu man alaiha fan, Quran says. Everything will be destroyed. Nothing will be left except the name of the God. That's what. And that's what we believe in as people of the faith. Whether we are Christians, we are Jews or Muslims. That's what we believe in universally. So what I'm saying to you, just by picking up these, you know, issues and aspects which displease you, which disturbs you, okay, and creates a intishar, a havoc in your mind about a faith, be it Christianity, Judaism, any faith, you have to understand that it does not go, you know, it doesn't rise to that level at all. There's no correlation. Leave the faith alone, brother. As long as people respect your faith, whatever your faith is, you respect others' faith. That's all. For me to engage in a debate between a believer and an atheist, I'm not stupid. I have no training, I have no knowledge, I have absolutely no background in that field. However, there are people who sit down for hours and hours and hours and get engaged into endless debate. You know, the between the people who are non-believers and believers. You are welcome to join. I will refer you to them, and you can raise these issues. But at no time I mean to by mentioning Islam and its virtues, or Christianity and its virtues, or Judaism's virtues, I'm trying to belittle people who don't believe in any faith. Thank you.
Thank you for, we raised very important issue now, questions very significant for all of us. We have to recognize Islam is experiencing one of the deepest crises in his history. Yeah. The same happened with Judaism in the past, with Christianity. And now our job is, our duties, we have to help real imams who are really represents real Islam to defend Islam values. I'm confident there are two Qurans, two versions of Qurans. One of them is a real Quran, which is piece of book of peace, I'm confident. And another one is fake, the challenge Muslims to kill others. It's unacceptable. Unfortunately, people like my brother, Agha Jafri, not so many, we have to help them to be united. No, there are no differences between Jews, Christians, and Muslims who are really believe in God. Therefore, time is running out. Unfortunately, even though we have rockets, bombs, and everything, we can do nothing with terrorism because we have to fight with an idea. It's the most powerful weapon is idea. Nobody can defeat an idea unless we can find the right keys to this idea. And we cannot defeat radicalism in Islam unless smart, moderate, real imams will fight with them on ideology field. And we have to help them. Thank you.
Fabio?
Have you raised your hand?
Yeah.
So I guess we are.
I was going to say that, you know, I totally agree with you on this, because I was thinking about it is very easy to create a narrative of hate. It's very easy to find disciples and followers for a narrative of hate and of power, but it is extremely difficult to disconstruct that narrative and build a narrative of peace and harmony and so on. So this is why I just want to re-emphasize what you just said. And it is extremely important that, as well as we put pressure on governments and NGOs and so on to try to decrease the higher power side of it, but also, as we have said already here, education is so important, because that's where we will construct the counter-narratives of hate with the narrative of peace and harmony, and try to build a better world. And it is so important that people we haven't except you in Stephen, but I lived in Europe for 22 years, and I teach university there, and secularism in Europe is a very, very strong force. And secularism in Europe wanted to sweep every single piece of religion out of the system.
Yeah.
And it's not a military power. It's an ideological power, it's an economic power. So we're talking about big narratives. But we will only help to disconstruct the ones of hate and try to build narratives of peace and harmony if each one of us believe in it. Because we're talking about believers, aren't we? If you believe in Marxism or if you believe in atheism, even atheists believe in something. If their belief is nothing in terms of God, they believe in something.
Yeah.
Like what?
Probably something.
No.
The only thing I believe that is, like, for example, I have to be happy in my life. But happiness is not a goal. It's a trick. I don't believe. I don't need to believe in nothing. And even that, I don't want that somebody wants to make me believe that I have to believe to be happy.
No, absolutely.
I don't need anything.
So this is belief in freedom, kind of. Belief in freedom.
Absolutely.
Right.
There are two ways in this narrative I'm here.
If, for example,
top, bottom and bottom up. And bottom up is from the families. It's what we teach our children. It's how we influence kindergarten school teachers. And then it's top down as well. You know what? I'm better than better. So I just want to agree with you.
Thank you.
I think we need to help those who are trying to construct a positive, harmonious narrative instead of trying to challenge theirs with what they want to combat and fight against, if you understand what I mean.
I think we are done, Mark.
Yeah, we need
to conclude the one moment we're going to have this for us, and we even have to say something. So, Shoshana, then we'll conclude. Please.
Years with various members of the prophet and at UN. One of our
Boris Pinkas. Boris Pinkas.
Pinkas.
Okay, so you mentioned Yom Kippur.
Yeah.
Which one, Brussels? In Paris or Brussels?
Where?
In Sevilla.
In Sevilla?
Yes.
We've been there, okay.
Good.
We've been there, okay.
So, unfortunately, that conversation has to be supported. We can speak afterwards now.
Please. Thank you.
Thank you.